Today on Open Source Data, I talk with Fabiana Clemente on her journey starting YData, public speaking, and being an introvert while leading and jumping into the founder role. I mean, it turns out it's part of the job. We also talk about some technical topics around synthetic data and privacy while keeping the topics pretty approachable. Listen to the end to hear Fabiana's two pieces of advice on starting a company. I think the second part is something everyone should practice. I know I still struggle with it. Hi, I'm Sharna Perkey, and you're listening to Open Source Data. Today, I'm talking to Fabiana Clemente, co-founder and chief data officer at YData. YData is accelerating AI with high-quality data. They're also the creator of the data-centric AI community, the place to discuss high-quality AI. And recently, YData profiling has earned a spot among the top 10 must-have Python libraries for data science. Fabiana herself is known for her technical prowess and her leadership capabilities, leading her team at YData towards significant growth and success. Recently, she has been named a top machine learning voice by LinkedIn. Welcome, Fabiana.
Hi, thank you. Thank you for the invite, Sharna.
Yeah,
it's pleasure super, to be here.
Super excited to have you. I mean, we have so many topics to cover. I was looking recently about some of the talks you've done on like ethical use of data and privacy and your journey, and just there's just so much stuff. And then I realized that you're in Seattle and I haven't actually met you in person. And I live in Seattle. And I was like, oh, we could have done this in person.
Yeah, that's true. But well, I don't know. There's something about Seattle that I'm always discovering new people that are in the same place as me and I never met them.
Yeah. Well, I for some reason, because I've seen you at so many SF conferences on the agenda, I was like, oh, she must live in SF. No.
Well, yeah, I understand that.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's sort of jump in with your journey then. So like, tell us a little bit about what got you into this. I mean, by this, I mean YData, but also you're such a big proponent of community. You speak in so many different places. So tell me a little bit about how that started and then how that shifted to the focus on synthetic data.
Okay. That's a very interesting question. So I guess the passion for data came from my background. I've studied applied mathematics, so it was an obvious kind of path to just work with data. Throughout my career as a data scientist, I was always struggling with data. Well, either access because of privacy and stuff, or, you know, I think everyone have been there at some point in time. or just because the quality are not there. I know, a bit of a cliche again, but it's true. Everyone tells you as a data scientist, you will be building models, but actually your work is data. It's not the model. So, and that, well, kind of inspired me in a sense that many people were exactly sharing the same struggles as I did, but it seems like the solutions we had at the time were not so focused on the data. So they were actually, if they were focused on the data, it was more around scale. So how you can process or how you can store the data correctly, which is great and is very foundational to all of this. But particularly in data preparation, there was a huge gap.
Yeah.
And so that was when my co-founder that was also working with data kind of said, well, why don't we do this ourselves? Why don't we start a company that is actually focused on building a development platform that is focused on making the data quality as good as it can be for machine learning purposes? And I thought, well, yeah, let's do that.
Start a company.
Why not? But that's as naive as that, right? Because, starting a company is not that easy, or it sounds, especially for a technical person like me, it sounds like, wow, I'll building a product, that's great. Doing a company is everything, but only the product, no. Well, as a founder, especially.
Yeah. So, I mean, I've been, this is probably my third start, is that right? No,
fourth startup.
Okay.
not as a founder, but I've been a VP of product, a VP of customer success. Okay. I've been in the engineering side on NLP and stuff. And so each time, you know, six people in a room, I remember we were in my first like real Seattle startup. We were in an apartment because we couldn't afford an office. So we just converted the apartment, desks all around, and we're like building IKEA furniture. We did like a company trip to IKEA and we're like piling desks on. It was lovely. And also you have to do everything.
Yep. Yes, exactly. It's something that nobody tells you, even as you said, even as someone that is not founder, but you are actually among the first hires.
Yeah.
It's something that nobody tells you. You are going to do everything.
You're going to do sales. You're going to do marketing. You're going to put your personal story out there, which I admire so much in the way that you do that, because that's been a personal challenge for me, is even though I love speaking, you know, I go to conferences, thousands of people, doesn't matter. Social media, oh, it's tough. There's some trolls out there. I hate it.
There are.
Yeah.
And well, I'm still uncomfortable about that, but I don't know. It's something that it's part of it. So,
yeah.
But yeah, that have been the journey. And one thing and you asked about community and why, you know, how the public speaking started. So I'm an introvert by nature. I hate to speak in public. I don't like big crowds. So, of course, speaking in public was not a natural decision, but it came as part of the job. It's the things that you are not expecting when you start a company.
Yeah.
Someone has to do it. It was me or my co-founder. And, well, we are both based on engineer, mathematics, so we are both kind of introverts.
Mm-hmm.
None of us was good. I was slightly better, I guess. That was a decision. But I do love community, you know. That's something I always liked. I always like to help others, share my experiences. And when I say experiences, the good and the bads, because, well, there are a lot of bads, and they teach you something anyways.
Yeah.
I thought, well, I don't like to speak in public, but I do like to help community, so why not?
Yeah.
Start as small. And then got used to.
Yeah, I think for me, at least in community, it makes it feel less like a room full of strangers who are judging me. Like if I know a bunch of people in the audience and it's sort of a continuation of a conversation that we're already having, much easier. But when it's a bunch of strangers and I have no idea how this is going to land, I'm like, all right. Just going to have to watch all your faces. And then I have to focus on the fact that it's a big audience. And I'm like, okay, calm down. You're sweating. but yeah, absolutely. I'm also an introvert. People tell me that I'm lying all of the time about that. And I'm like, no, I'm good at making a one-on-one person feel good. Doesn't mean I'm good at, you know, afterwards, I have to like shut it down, get a snack, put some headphones on, you know, and it's, anyway.
Yeah, I totally understand you. It's like your social battery, like, kind of drains.
It's gone.
And that's that. Yeah. That's that.
Yeah. But despite all of that, you're doing some amazing work. So tell me about, I guess, some of those contributions that YData has been doing for open source. You know, the top 10 library thing. I know that you've got at least two, maybe it's two, different packages, one on the generative side of the data, the other on the data quality. Tell me a little bit more about that.
So that was something that came with as part of our journey. So it's like on one side, nobody, when we started, generative AI was not out there. Mm-hmm. So, well, that's that. And then the concept of synthetic data was like, a wild dream that nobody understood really. And a lot of the questions were, what is it? How is it done? How is it generated? How can I trust it? And there is no better way of trusting one thing than having access to it. And when I say access to it, fully access. So all the details. And I guess that was one of the reasons that why the synthetic data open source came up as a way to answer questions and at the same time also democratize the concept.
Yeah.
So this is what synthetic data is. These are the methods. These are the pros and cons of each method. And this is what you should know about it.
Yeah. But because before, privacy essentially meant lock all your data away, which to your point earlier means data scientists can't do their job. So, yeah. And then we came up with various like differential privacy and things started to become a topic. But I think you got started in this before, you know, that became an actual possible reality. It was in an academic journal, I think several years ago, but no one actually could implement it.
That's correct. Yes. When we started was there were one or two players in the market, but they just started just like us. And everything was very based on academia. So the traditional anonymization was lock it up or mask everything, make data not usable at all for machine learning. And that was the decision. As a data scientist, of course, I do believe privacy is needed.
Yeah.
And I'm a big proponent of privacy, but I don't think you need to lose the utility of the data for privacy.
And
it's a balance.
I think that's also what led us to some of the demographic-based data science. Essentially, you know, folks were making like event data into pre-aggregated data, and then they were trying to obscure it so much that you couldn't get back to the person. And so you're like, okay, what's their age and what's their gender? And you're like, that's not actually the most useful part of data science. That can't predict behavior or intent or any of that. It throws out time as a component of the entire process, seasonality, everything. And so there has to be a better way. And I think through some of the synthetic data, at least the conversation that I've been hearing, even all the way up to the World Economic Forum, it's still a question of, can we use synthetic data? Is it better? Can it fill the gaps? You know, and there's all of these misconceptions around, is it ethical? You know, if it doesn't actually represent, you know, the right sets of things, then maybe it's not.
And that's actually something very funny, because sometimes we do receive like a message that your synthetic data has this bias or this behavior that we have just identified, and we go, okay, let's check your original data. The bias and the problems are already there.
Yeah.
It's just you were not assessing them.
Uh-huh.
So yeah, synthetic data is not a bulletproof or a magic thing that will solve your issues. It can have an issue of bias, but especially if you don't have any, you know, processes in place to really assess that. That's actually where the profiling came from. So it's from this conception that we had this assumption that everybody knew how to profile their data. That's the basic stuff. We started based on that, that assumption. It was a huge mistake. That's huge. It's like, no, that assumption is totally wrong. So because I assume exploratory data analysis or data profiling is the basic step of everything. So you must do it. And then we were seeing people doing the same thing every time, the same team having different insights because they were using different functions. And we thought, okay, this can actually be really helpful for the community. We had it for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
Why not have it or have it supported for a lot of people and build something that actually the community will feel grateful about? So we decided to share more in the sense that while this is needed, we have it. Why not?
Right.
Yeah, I was looking at the numbers the other day because when you start raising money, you start looking at total addressable market and like who your personas are and everything. And I think the last number I saw is there's only something like 600,000 data scientists, and there are millions of developers. And I'm like, yep, of course we have a data problem, data profiling problem, right? It's still these resources and these tools are like locked away into this specialty sort of thing. And so everyone is trying to be data driven. Every company has gone through some sort of digital transformation in the last 10 years. And so now we have everyone trying to be a data scientist, mm-hmm. but without the right tools.
Yeah. And it's so overlooked, the profiling, that it's insane, because there is another assumption that every day we bump into, which is, the data is mine, so of course it has high quality. I'm the one collecting the data, so. But don't get me wrong, the data can be completed, can have quality in terms of structure, schema, because you are an engineer or a data engineer, you have done a great job. But that doesn't mean that your data is actually ready for machine learning. Might be missing something. Mm-hmm.
Well, I think that that's part of, like, data engineering is its own specialty and is completely independent of machine learning in a lot of cases, unless you find, like, a full-stack ML person.
And it exactly.
You don't know what you need in ML before you know you need it. And so what happens, I think, is people start collecting data. They're like, this is all we're ever going to need. And then someone tries to use that for machine learning, and they're like, we need these five other components. So it ends up being this big iteration cycle, because you discover it's a chaotic space. We're not modeling a finite system, right? We're modeling humans and human behavior.
Exactly.
So of course, you're not going to have perfect data, and it's going to be a perpetual problem.
And it's fine, uh-huh. you know? It is fine. It's, I think, as long as companies accept that's the normal process, I think things work.
Yeah,
I'm not expecting a data engineer or data software person to like, oh, I need this data. No, it's impossible until you know when and how you want to be using the data.
Right.
It's very hard for you to predict everything. So.
Right. And we don't have infinite storage either. Oh, it's getting cheaper and cheaper every time, but it's not infinite.
It's not. It's
at least, you know, when I look at the bills that we get, this we have a lot of storage, but it's not still not infinite.
Exactly.
Well, then, okay. So recently you gave this talk about the role of synthetic data in generative AI. I know generative wasn't really around before you started, but now it is. And it's still data science, still machine learning, and there's still a data quality problem. So what has changed in this sort of era of foundation models, and what do you see the role of synthetic data in this space?
Foundation models have changed a lot of things, and they do have great stuff. But they also highlighted some misconceptions at the same time. It's amazing, the duality of the new tech. So it's great. They brought like machine learning or the potential of AI for like everybody in the world, right? So it's worldwide now. It's not just a small segment of people seeing the capabilities of these models. But they made people believe that this goes like magic.
Yeah.
And there is no need for verifications, validations, and things like that. So interestingly enough, the data quality issue is, of course, still there. The hallucinations, of course, are an issue as well. And I think that's where synthetic data is gaining a lot of traction. First, because it's a generative AI-driven kind of process. Everybody is now getting more familiar with it. And on the other hand, is also the capability of, okay, we now are kind of understanding how data-savvy these systems are. And how hard can it be to collect some of the events that we need and the variability that we need? That synthetic data is now understood as a way to stress test systems to introduce more variability on the training data, to even validate hallucinations or kind of control hallucinations. So it's the both sides, the good and the bad. But on the synthetic data, I think there are more positive, a very positive impact on awareness. And it accelerated a lot, the market on synthetic data.
Yeah, I forgot who wrote the paper, but there was this paper about using generative AI to generate the synthetic data. And as you just said, generating synthetic data is a generative process already. And so it's sort of, you know, makes maybe the profiling and the understanding of what's needed even more important. You underrepresenting mm-hmm. something in a generative model means that it just doesn't exist anymore. So I think it's interesting that people feel like they're discovering synthetic data for the first time. And I'm like, it's been around for a long time. My PhD had this in it. I think, you know, my first job, I was in it was in embedded systems. I was a digital signal processing is what I studied. And so, you know, we would have sensor systems and everything. We'd have all of this data. There'd be missing points in the middle. We'd need to do things like interpolation or whatever. And yeah. It feels like, you know, every 50 years or something, people are rediscovering the same concepts. And you're like, yeah, it's totally new.
Yeah, I think that's funny because that's exactly, it sounds like, what we see in other areas like fashion and stuff, things like that existed already for years, but suddenly they are super sexy. So
oh man, I love bell bottom jeans so much. Like I am not a rectangular shaped person. Yeah. I'm a very like curvy person. And so when I was a kid, I found my mom's, they were called elephant ear jeans. Like the bells on the bottom were bigger than your hips. And I was like,
okay.
Yes. And she showed me how to make those when I was a teenager. And they're finally coming back now. So I'm really excited. But I know I need to buy like 7 pairs of jeans so that when they go out of style again, I can keep
you can be stocked.
I can be stocked. Yeah. Yeah. Turns out I'm not the best at making jeans. I am a maker in every sense of the word. Like I've got like hobbies. I'm a collector of hobbies.
Okay.
And I tried, you know, I have a sewing machine. I can sew a lot of things for whatever reason. Like every time I try to work on jeans, I like break the needle. Okay. And I'm like, okay, Sharna, watch the YouTube video again. You can do now. No, I just buy my jeans now. So anyway.
Okay.
Anyway, back on topic. Okay. So you mentioned though, like this generative AI, it's sort of captured the imagination and it made them think it was magic. So I think there's two sides to this, right? There's the data literacy issue, the AI literacy issue. Mm-hmm. You know, I know mm-hmm. the majority of the population, even when they do a Google search without generative, they're like, oh, that must be a fact, right? We had this
right
issue with when the pandemic was here and people were like, I'll just need to take vitamin C or I just need to, you know, and you're like, just because it's on the internet doesn't mean it's real. And and it's made it even harder.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
the generative models give you reasoning. They tell you, well, here's why I think that. And they'll cite sources that don't exist. And then people have a degree of confidence. So you've got sort of the literacy issue. But I think you also have some camps of experts that are saying, well, this is the start of AGI. And there was a lot of hype around this, you know, early last year. Yeah. And I'm not personally in the camp of like, this is the beginning of AGI, but I work with people and some of my friends are in that camp. And so I'm still struggling with this sort of like, it's not magic, guys. I don't know if you have thoughts on that.
I do have. Actually, it's something that I don't know who told me this, but there were a lot of people asking for persons like Sam Altman or even Ian LeCun if why it's taking so long for us to achieve AGI. This question has popped up.
Yeah.
And the AI literacy that this brought was great, but again, in my opinion, and I guess I might be wrong in the future, I share the same thoughts as they told. Well, this will take a lot of years. It's not something that is, I know it sounds like LLMs behave like a human because they finally can answer your questions. But this is not even close to AGI.
Right.
It gives the perception that we are almost there.
Yeah.
But it's not, and will take a lot of time. And actually, I do recommend a lot the last article from Yen LeCun, the object-driven AI, exactly because he explains it so well, why we are not there, and while perhaps generative AI is not even the answer to AGI. I think we will reach that point. But I'm also struggling to see that generative AI will be the answer, especially with such limitations on the data quality. Because people have to understand. So it's the same as Google. Of course, it's great, but it's the average of the internet. You still have to filter a lot of stuff. And we have to see that generative AI is still making simple mistakes as sometimes confusing a cat with a dog or whatsoever. So I know we humans also do errors or mistakes, but we do have a context of the world that the systems don't have and can't build. And I think that's when we achieve that understanding of the world in that context, I think that's when we might be a bit closer to AGI.
Yeah. I think one of the pieces that makes it feel like the first step is the language component, right? NLP has been around for a long time, but if we think about how human learning accelerated, it was through learning language and then connecting with each other and then evolving ideas. So sort of this, like, what if hallucinations are actually ideas and dreams that we could, you know, somehow harness and evolve and like turn. And to be fair, hallucinations are great when you're trying to use generative for, you know, sci-fi art or writing fiction books or things like that. And it is potentially possible that you could take a hallucination and say, all right, well, if I wanted that world to exist, hey, LLM, tell me why you think it already does. And maybe you can place some bets or whatever. But it's still, it's not quite the same as humans learning language, because this is a statistical process. This is a word is likely to come next, not
exactly.
How does this idea make this other idea possible? It's not that.
That's a very beautiful way to put it. Hallucinations, I have to say. I never thought about that, and it makes a lot of sense. I do think, though, that in terms of LLMs, definitely it sounds like we are getting very intelligent system, exactly because language is very complex and we know that was needed for the leap of humanity. I do think there are other, the sense of combining, and here we enter in the multimodal kind of space.
Yeah.
It's what's missing. Because I think, like, kids start understanding the world through vision, then touch. And finally, language. Language is actually the one of the last that we kind of developed. So I don't want to say that AI needs to follow exactly the same steps as we do, because that's probably wrong. I do feel that the multimodal aspect that is starting now will play a big role.
Yeah, absolutely. Until there's sort of this sensing, acting component. And I think that's kind of where the agent architectures are going, is, you know, let's give a language model the ability to, I don't know, access sensor data, etc. So, like, providing more and more context. It's fun to watch it evolve. It's fun to help it evolve. But I think that probably brings me to why in this season we wanted to talk a little bit more about impact, because I think we're glossing over a bit. You know, we jumped from we have this new thing to AGI, but there's this whole journey in the middle, right? Yep. There are actual real use cases where we're seeing impact that we haven't seen before. One example that I love is in supply chain, for example, shipping and receiving. We've had all of these documents for a long time. Each form at each port is different. And everyone's tried to use like OCR to try and interpret them. And an LLM is a great place to extract that information and ask questions of those documents. It's something that, you know, people just gave up on before. So part of what I'd love to hear from you is, what are some of the use cases where you're seeing impact today that is actual real impact versus, you know, the dreams of AGI?
A very good one. Definitely, I think the side of the documents and helping to and by the way, I see this also in code, right? Even I do think it will accelerate a lot the development. And I'm also as someone that is founder and has to work on several aspects, I'm also seeing the scenarios like marketing, content creation. I'm not saying they are bulletproof or better than experts. They aren't, but they actually are very good at just creating something else than a white canvas, right? It's harder for you to start from zero or from scratch. At least I feel like that.
Yeah.
It's like, okay. And they really accelerate that. Also in terms of code, it's like, how many times have you done a repetitive piece of line of code that everyone does it, and you have to run through Google just to find it? And well, it can help a lot on that. It can help also in making code review faster. So I do think there are a lot of use cases that can accelerate teams and helping teams to become more organized, more managed, have better communication, spot errors more easily. And those are the use cases I see. So code development, a lot around context, content development, document analysis. So information management inside companies as well, because that's a nightmare. So yeah. I do think those, at least those four, are can be changed a lot by LLMs.
Yeah. And it sounds like there's kind of two camps there. One is where there's some sort of human emotional barrier, right? A blank page, whether it's for writing or drawing or anything, is so much harder than reacting to something, right?
It's intimidating.
Right. Yeah. Like you see something and you're like, it's not that. So at least you know that's not. And then, you know, you can generate it again. You can ask it different ways. And it just to get, I don't know, something about, at least for me, context switching is hard. I do a lot of tactical operational work. And to get into a creative headspace where I can even string the right words together, it's hard. So normally I would go find a person and sit them down and be like, all right, talk this idea through with me. Yeah. Or we did whiteboarding sessions and things like that. Just to get another person to get us past that. So I love that a lot of the use cases are falling into that space. And I think I would even recommend anyone who is struggling in their job, like you're procrastinating and you're finding yourself avoiding something.
Yeah.
Just try the generative stuff and see if it gets you unstuck. But the other side, I think what you're pointing out is there is some access to a broader corpus, whether it's code and you've, you know, copy-pasted the same code in 12 different code bases. If an LLM is reviewing your code and it has access to many more experts, you can certainly make it better in a very technical way. Where does the synthetic data, you think, come into play for either giving LLMs context to reduce hallucinations or in training the foundational models where, you know, maybe you have underrepresented data and you need some sort of representation to even learn a task.
I think it will play a more important role, if you ask me, on the second one.
Okay.
Because that's something that, well, hallucinations can help with guardrails. They are great as well. They can help on that. So I do think when it comes to balance kind of behaviors or even to create some behaviors that you were not able to collect will be very important for making these models a bit more fair as well, in some sense, and more robust to different situations. Because again, we have a big corpus, internet or even inside a company, the private data, it's great. But how many times a new process started and you were not ready for that new process? Or how many times were you seeing changes in society or how human behaves, and now your data set is not ready for that and your machine learning models are not that good? So actually, COVID was very good at proving exactly that point. So how you were not ready for sudden changes in terms of machine learning. And that's where I think synthetic data can play the biggest role in all of this. Not only about privacy, but really makes us more confident about the models we are putting out there.
Yeah, I like that. Well, we're getting close to the end of our time, and I have three questions I always ask guests on the podcast. And I want to make sure you had time to answer those. So the first is, what does the term open source data mean to you? You know, you're coming from a data science background, but also a place where you're contributing to the data in the open source and the profiling and, you know, different people, this is not a widely accepted term to use, but that's what the name of the podcast is. So yeah. What does open source data mean to you?
That's a tough one. And I think I don't have yet a good definition. Because again, I could say that everything that is in the internet is open source data. But open source data, theoretically, if you follow the logic of open source, it should be, of course, data that you have some sort of licensing to use by a wider community, where you have actually documented the processes and flows to have it collected, where, when, by whom. So have all that catalog. Actually, for me, open source data would be something more on the and yeah. This is perhaps a more strict definition. For me, the data in the internet, I wouldn't say it's open source. I would say it's widely available data, which is a bit different.
Right. Absolutely. I think that's part of where a lot of the conversations around ethics of LLMs and the data that train them, like, content creators didn't give permission, et cetera, et cetera. Like, that's where all that whole conversation came from. I don't, especially when something was copyrighted, it probably.
Yeah. Because I do think there are a lot of gray areas, and I understand, but I try to put sometimes, I don't have a strong opinion around that, but sometimes I think of myself. So I have social media. Okay. They are not, well, not all of them are public, but some of them are. And I wouldn't enjoy to see a photo of mine that I was intending to share with people being used for a model, for a deepfake, or whatever other purposes. So I feel that about myself, but I can't put myself on the shoes of someone that is creating art on the same. So I had a lot of work and thought process to, I don't know, create a painting, create a photography even. And all of a sudden, everyone is using my information without asking me to just generate variations of my work. I wouldn't be so happy about that either. So.
Yeah, it seems like we might need some sort of method of attribution, and whether it's
credit or payment or something. Because at least then you're giving back. So anyway, larger conversation.
it's a hard topic for sure.
Yeah. Okay. So then shifting gears a little bit. A lot of times we get interviewed or asked to speak on things because someone else needs something or wants something from us. And I think that it's a good question to ask. What do you wish someone would ask you about or interview about? It doesn't have to be about work. It can be about anything, but it's something where it's important to you and you're like, man, why doesn't anyone ever ask me about this? Like I have, you know.
Yeah. That's the, especially when I became a founder, this kind is a question that sometimes I do wish that I was asked is, how are you doing? But really, how are you?
Yeah.
Because this is everybody, and of course, not just as a founder, you can also make a parallel in your personal life with this. But as a founder, I have, and as someone that loves community and have a community and have open source, you have so many people with expectations about you, asking you about things, like wanting your time. But then, you know, of course, you have to come through for a lot of those. But you are a bit drained, or you are like, yeah, today perhaps I'm not in my best mood. But of course, everybody expects that you are in your top performance. So yeah, sometimes I would love to have someone really ask, how are you? But really, how are you?
Right.
Because sometimes can be exhausting, for sure.
Exhausting, but also, I don't know. There's a type of pressure, right? Like the employees that work for you, the paychecks, the fundraising, the runway, the making the right, the buck stops here, you know? And I think there's this issue where we think of people as their role and not as people.
Yes, that summarizes very well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, how are you?
Tough times this year, for sure. 2024, it's going to be interesting. But yeah.
Well, if you ever want to talk about it, I'm here in Seattle. Give me a call. Guarantee you, I'm not always okay. Sometimes when somebody asks me this at work, because I've tried to normalize this question, like I like my eyes water and I'm like, not right now. I'm about to head into this thing where I actually have to be okay, and we can ask me in an hour.
Exactly.
Thank you, and put a pin in that.
Exactly.
Cool. So then the last one is just sort of the flip side of that, which is, you know, what advice do you have, right? It can be about starting a company, it can be about open source, but advice on, you know, what is it like to do this, and what would you recommend to, you know, succeed or be okay, or, you know?
Yeah, there are a couple things, of course. I do recommend the journey. It's an interesting journey. You grow a lot, so if you are questioning yourself, you should start it or not the company. If the market is viable and so on, and you feel like it's the right idea, go for it. It's something that it will be hard, but it's a very enriching experience. But one thing that as a founder or as someone that is building a company or doing even a project, does not need to be a company, value your time and learn how to say no. It's just a expectation management for the others. and for yourself. Because you tend to think, I can do this as well. I can do that as well. And all of a sudden you have 30 different tasks that you have to do and you have no time. That time comes from someplace. So have that in mind.
Yeah. I like that last one. I've worked with people who say yes to everything, and I feel like I can't necessarily rely on them for anything because their plate is always too full. And then there are people who will tell me no, and I'm like, no, but is like really though? Because if it's really a no, like I need to go figure this out somewhere else. And then they're like, yes. But respecting that no, like, man, I know I can count on those people. It's so hard for me to say no. And I have this very high commitment to always delivering when I say yes. And so the struggle, or at least the conversation in therapy for me, is why do I want to say yes? And why do I think that other person's need is bigger than my own?
Yeah.
To sleep, to eat food, like work through lunch and sustenance is probably more important than that report that they need, right? And yeah, learning to say no, I'm still working on it.
Oh, no, totally. Me as well, because you think about the others, you think about pleasing and helping because you like to help as well. So, mm-hmm. So when you are community driven, you like it.
Yeah.
But then there is a toll. There is always. So
yeah, absolutely. Well, I think that's a good place to stop. Thank you so much for this conversation. It's been wonderful. And hopefully I'll see you around, whether it's in Seattle or on the conference circuit. I'm headed down to California on Sunday for a hackathon with Llama Index. And so,
That sounds exciting.
Super exciting. I'm a judge on the competition. So I get to listen to 200 people. The whole theme is more than chatbots or something like that. We'll see what they come up with. Yeah.
Okay. Looking forward. This was a pleasure. Thank you for the invite. And yeah, see you around.
All right. We'll see you. I'm backstage with our executive producer, Leo Godoy, to cover his takeaways from the conversation. Leo, I thought that conversation with Fabiana was fruitful. It left me feeling creative, especially with engaging on topics like AGI and different ways to think about the role of language in the perception of AI's magic. There was a grounding in data that Fabiana clearly has, and she just has a deep understanding of where we're going. What stood out to you?
Well, Sharna, I agree with you in the sense that it was very fruitful, but to me, something that I want to ask you is that Fabiana, very early on in the episode, she says that she used to have a little bit of a hard time when talking in public and all that, and feeling a bit introvert. But she's so good at communicating her message. And what I wanted to hear from you is how important it is to have someone that knows, all the technical stuff, but also knows how to communicate her message to people to feel engaged, to join the conversation, even if they don't have a tech background, but at the same time, people that do understand about it.
Yeah. I mean, how important is it? It's incredibly important. I think that it is very difficult to succeed. As she kind of mentioned, either her or her co-founder had to do it. There is really no way to found a company if you're not engaging with people of different backgrounds. You have to pitch to investors. You have to give talks at different companies and different conferences. And you have to engage the community. So it's so important to have someone who's willing to have the conversation. And I think that the more and more you can engage where someone is, that's what actually makes it a conversation and not just, standing up there and preaching whatever it is that you have to say. You're never going to get to understanding, engagement, connection in conversation unless you're meeting them where they are. And I think Fabiana has an amazing capacity to do that, whether it's, making sure that she's following the right altitude throughout the conversation as we go up and down, but also in a personal way, right? Like, she wants people to ask her how she's doing. And part of communicating is that emotional side. If you don't know what someone's bringing into the room with them, you're missing part of it. So I think the emotional intelligence is also incredibly important in this type of role. I think I'll leave it there. Thank you. And thanks to our audience for listening.